innovate, enable.
Hello and welcome to a fresh new episode of NSE FinWiz Season 6, powered by CNBC TV 18. I'm your host Nisha Podar, and through this show, we are going to help you understand the basics of financial planning and also guide you to make sound investment decisions. We are today in Mumbai at the campus of eClerx.
Founded in the year 2000, eClerx is a process management firm specializing in innovative business processes, change management, analytics, and data-driven insights. The company provides critical business operation services to over 50 global Fortune 500 clients and employs over 9,000 people. This week, NSE FinWiz organized an interactive session for the employees of eClerx, where they got an opportunity to share their questions with financial experts on the road to long-term financial prosperity.
Financial literacy is to understand where and how whatever the funds available to you is, how optimum utilization you will do with those funds is what is financial literacy.
Financial literacy to me means handling your finances in such a way that it can be helpful to you in the near future.
I have high standards and expectations for this session what will be conducted right now. Since I am into a saving zone, I want to know what profit I will be getting out of it and where best I can invest my money and get lesser losses.
Hello and welcome to NSE FinWiz Season 6, powered by CNBC TV 18. And this time, our theme is invest in yourself, and it's the path to prosperity. We are here in Mumbai at eClerx campus, and we have two experts joining us to take us through the financial planning and wealth creation. And happy to introduce Harsh Rungta as well as Pankaj Matpal. Thank you so much, gentlemen, for joining us, and thanks to the employees of eClerx for joining us. Now, my first question to Harsh then, what is the basic mantra for financial investment, Harsh?
I think people, when they start investing, their only thing is to make money, which is good. But what will they use the money for? So I think having a clear-cut goal gives you a direction.
Right.
It gives you the ability to invest in the right place. Mm. So never begin investing before having that goal.
So you begin the journey knowing where the which is the destination you want to go to, and that makes the journey even more clearer. Pankaj, what do you have to say in a nutshell? What is the main thing that one should focus on?
Investment is a process, and objective is to achieve some goal. So without knowing your goal, if you are investing, then there is no guarantee whether you will achieve that or no. So focus should be on the achievement of goal than the investment.
Now, let's get into the nitty-gritties. A lot of people actually confuse financial investing with tax planning. Let's discuss that first. Who wants to go first?
The tax break only enhances your return. When you get a tax break, it increases your return. I think people just forget that. There is something about getting something from the government that, you know, impels people to do it. Please find out whether that investment is worth it. And I think the biggest culprit there is insurance, and the biggest culprit are investors themselves, who wait till the last minute, and then just to save tax, they will invest in an instrument that is easily available and is sold aggressively.
How do you define a financial goal and work towards that?
Now, when you want to achieve your goal in, say, next 3 years, 4 years, so it's a short period of time. But when you want to achieve some goal after 20 years, you have a very long time horizon. Every asset class has its importance, but like equity in long term, we have always seen it delivers very attractive returns compared to other asset classes. But in short term, equity has a nature of volatility. Market is sometimes up, sometimes down. Debt, it gives you limited returns, but it provides stability to the portfolio. So what you have to decide that how much time you have in your hand to achieve your desired goal.
So what do you think in terms of the short-term goals? Do people, should people have short-term goals as well?
See, I think goals are things that you aspire for. Okay, so I mean, you cannot, for example, have a goal for regular medical expenditure. You cannot, for example, have a goal for meeting the regular education expenses of your child. That has to come out of your regular income. Like most people, people have aspirational holidays. Depends on what level of life you are in. If there is an aspirational holiday you have towards which you have to create a corpus, then that is a goal. Buying a consumer durable can be a goal, especially if it's very expensive. I mean, car being a typical example, buying a house obviously can be a goal. And it can be short term, it can be 3 years, 5 years, etc. So obviously you will have short term goals.
All right, so I have first one coming in from Sangeeta Gharat. You can ask your question, the one which you have mentioned over here, Sangeeta.
If I want to buy a house within, say, about 5 years, and if I'm ready to invest 30,000 per month, is that possible?
See, for buying a house, is you need a lot of money.
Yeah.
And you will have to take some loan, that is understood. But for down payment, you have to do your planning. For this kind of goal, I will say, you should have investment in diversified equity fund, mostly in large cap, some part in mid cap. Don't go for sector specific schemes, this kind of goal and this time horizon. And when you are near to the goal, say after 3 years, you should have less exposure to equity and more in debt.
All right, on that note, we'll come to the end of this segment. Let's take a quick break on the show, but come back to discuss more on the focused approach on conventional versus the new age investment products. And we'll be taking more questions and discussing more on that on this show. So stay tuned. Welcome back. You're watching NSE FinWiz Season 6, powered by CNBC TV 18. And in this segment, we are going to discuss various products and the difference between the conventional as well as the new age products for financial planning. So let me go straight to our experts then. What do you think is the difference now in the kind of gamut of investment products that are available today? And how do we compare and put them in separate buckets?
Most of traditional plan, they lack the opportunity to create wealth. They are good for saving, but as we see here, people have high aspiration. To achieve those goals, you have to create wealth. Traditional plan may not help you to achieving your goals. That is why you have to think about the newer products. Here, mutual funds is the best choice. Why? Because managed by professionals, provide you flexibility, convenient administration, and it gives you opportunity to invest in different asset class. Equity, gold, debt, means bonds, debenture, whatever is your choice, they will give you opportunity to invest in that asset class. But you have to decide that for what you're investing and how much time you have.
All right. So, Harsh, what are the various criteria which you should keep in mind before choosing the product, horizon, in returns, and what are the others?
Any investment from the most basic to the most complicated product, there are only three things: risk, return, and liquidity. When you go for so-called low risk, right, that your principal is not at risk, okay, the return is not going to be high.
Right.
There is no instrument in the world that can deliver you high returns with low risk. It's not possible. Right, anywhere in the world, and it's not possible in India. So I think these are the only three. If you want liquidity, okay, you'll have to sacrifice return. If you don't want liquidity, you can go for a less liquid instrument in the hope that it will give you a better return. So I think it's always an interplay. Whenever we say equity or debt or anything else, gold or real estate, it's always a play between risk, return and liquidity.
Right, so time for questions then. My first question is coming from Sagar Shetty.
So down the line, in the next 10, 15 years, I want to stop what I'm currently doing and just focus on teaching. So what should be the right combination of what the new age products, all the conventional products, should I invest now so that I get a fixed salary or a fixed income when I start my passion, follow my passion completely?
Again, the traditional plan do not have much scope of generating wealth for you. Some allocation for your need, you should have some allocation, but most of the investment should go in mutual funds, not only equity, but some hybrid funds should be in your portfolio. Start through SIP route, that is always good, and keep increasing this amount. But yes, traditional plan only for your contingency, only where you want the fixed return this time, not for future, that you should have in a portfolio. But for the goal of achieving this after 10 years, my recommendation is only mutual funds through SIP route, most part in equity, some part in debt.
Next question comes in from Manoj Kumar Sharma.
My question is that what should be the percentage allocation in my portfolio if I'm looking for a financial freedom in, let's say, next 15 years and I'm investing regularly around 25,000, 30,000?
Most people don't have only a single goal, right? We had, a dream holiday. Somebody wanted a child's education. The point that I'm trying to make is asset allocation can't be the same, even for you, for all goals put together. Okay? So if there is something that you need to do in 5 years' time and that is important to you, the asset allocation that you would have there would be different than what you would have for the 15 years. But let's say if the 15-year goal was the only goal that you had, and let me assume that you are somebody who's able to take at least a moderate or a moderately aggressive risk profile, then I would say that anywhere between 50 to 80% should be equity, 20 to 30-40% should be debt, maybe a portion that's slightly... not something everybody prefers, but maybe 5% to gold.
All right, Rohit Ashokan, his question next.
I just wanted to ask that with the small sum of rupees 1,000, what is the best option or alternative for me to invest in it for a long term?
So if you want to invest 1,000 rupees from beginning for long term and keep increasing that amount year after year, it will really help you achieving your retirement goal. So start early for 1,000 rupees in the beginning. Start with hybrid scheme. Just to taste the market, I will not say that you go for equity scheme. Go for hybrid scheme. Start investing through SIP route. So that after that you taste the success, you will automatically keep increasing your investment amount. This will be for retirement.
All right, on that note, we'll take a short break and we'll come back with more questions from the employees of eClerx as they try to really understand the financial investments, and our experts, Harsh as well as Pankaj, will be guiding them more. Take a short break and get back. Welcome back. You're watching NSE FinWiz Season 6, powered by CNBC TV 18. We are in the last segment where we are going to take more questions from the employees of eClerx, and our financial experts are going to answer them. All right, let me throw the floor open then. Who wants to ask the first question?
What is the risk factor if I do a systematic investment plan from my side instead of going to a mutual fund?
If you're investing in equity mutual fund, money is going in equity shares, right? Also, which you could do directly. Right. But neither that is your profession, nor you will have plenty of time for doing these all things. Right. That is why my suggestion is on mutual funds. Coming to cost, see, SEBI has made it very clear on the expense. And in mutual fund, in equity schemes also, total expense ratio, if you see, it is around 2 to 2.5%.
Right.
If you open a DMAT account, you pay transaction charges. That is also cost.
Right.
So if you compare the cost also, it is not very high with what you invest directly. That is why my focus is that you invest in equity, but go through mutual fund.
Even within equities, there are different categories of mutual funds, like large cap, mid cap, small cap. those kind and industry specific. So as an investor, when I'm researching, mostly, you know, I just compare, say, 1 month return, 1 year, 3 year, 5 year returns, percentages. What is other fundamental, realities about these different categories which we should know when we are deciding on where to invest?
For a common investor, my suggestion that your 60-70% allocation should be in large cap and 35-40% should be in mid cap. Small caps are only when you want to invest for long time horizon and you have a long time horizon. And second thing, your portfolio is quite reasonable and some 10% around you want to allocate in small cap. So for you, like you want to start, so large cap, mid cap in 60-40 ratio, it is a good choice. Now, what to see there, consistency is important. See, there may be a scheme which had delivered higher return in last 1 year, but if you see the 5 years average, it is not so good. Another scheme which has not given very high return last 1 year, but average if you see it is good. So we have not to see only the returns in rally, in the bull market, but also when the market falls, how much downside is protected.
Actually, there is one question. There are two products, FD and FMP. So I just wanted to know what is your view, which is most beneficial if I give you two products, FD and FMP?
Let us assume that the FMP that you are talking about is going to put money, it's not allowed, but let's say it's going to put money 100% into bank FD. Because when you put money into an FMP, and most FMPs would be 3 year plus always, okay, you are not going to be able to liquidate in between, or the cost of liquidating in between is pretty high, right? That is the cost you are paying for putting it in the FMP. Yes. What is the advantage you are getting? Because it is treated as a capital asset, you don't pay tax on the interest every year. You will get indexing benefit. Effectively, if you are in a high tax bracket, you will end up paying tax of around 8-10% depending on what the indexing is, versus the 30% that you would have paid year on year when you put money in an FD.
Right.
So between the two, if liquidity is not a serious concern, you should always choose an FMP.
So I hope it was fruitful for all of you, and it helped you understand your financial goals and how to invest and how to create wealth. All right, I'm afraid that that's all the time that we have on the show. So we've come to the end of this episode of NSE FinWiz Season 6, powered by CNBC TV 18. I hope a lot of important questions were really answered when it comes to financial investments and for wealth creation. And I thank our financial experts, both Harsh as well as Pankaj, for joining us and for a great audience here at the campus of eClerx. With that, I thank the audience for tuning in to CNBC TV 18 for this. Also, do follow the latest updates on our website, nscfinwiz.com, and also follow us on Facebook as well as Twitter. Keep investing and stay tuned to CNBC TV 18. Thanks so much.
I really like this overall concept of CNBC coming to the premises and, you know, sharing this valuable information with the employees. And I can proudly say that I am going to go back and start investing more.
The overall session was very knowledgeable, and it will give us very different types of investment, where we can invest and for how long we can invest.
The session was too great. I understand what to invest, where to invest now. Earlier, my all saving used to get into bank saving account. So definitely I want to change my investment plan now.
Focus. Ideate. Innovate. Enable.